VMware patches 10 flaws, one of them is critical. Math breaks post-quantum encryption using a single core PC, and the emergency alert system can be hacked. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for August 9th, 2022. This is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. I have a special announcement. You've probably already heard it if you've been listening to the past few ThreatWire episodes. I will be at DEF CON this weekend, filming a special episode of ThreatWire, and I'm also having a meetup. So the meetup is happening at this place called Beer House on Saturday the 13th at 7 p.m. I'm not booking any space there, so just show up if you want to hang out. If anything changes, I will post about it on my social media, so keep an eye on my Twitter and Instagram for details. I'm at Snubs, that's S-N-U-B as in boy, S, on both of those platforms. Also, if you are a Happy Waffle tier patron, check your Patreon DMs for details on a VIP private meetup just for y'all. I haven't posted any details on that one yet, but I will send you a direct message once that meetup has been confirmed. Thank you again so much for supporting my content in whichever way you do it. I seriously am so excited for DEF CON. I'm packing right now and I'm just getting more and more excited. I haven't been there in like 3 years, so I'm very stoked. Let's go ahead and get started with today's news. VMware is recommending users update products ASAP to fix 10 different flaws that has CVE scores between 9.8, which is critical, down to 4.7, which is moderate. These all have separate CVEs, and they do affect a variety of VMware products, including Workspace ONE Access, Access Connector, Identity Manager, vRealize Automation, Cloud Foundation, and Identity Manager Connector, and the vRealize Suite Lifecycle Manager. The issues include a few local privilege escalation bugs, which would require an attacker to have local access, but it could give them root credentials. One of the flaws is a reflected cross-site scripting vulnerability, and this one could allow for improper user sanitization, leading to malicious JavaScript code being inputted. Of all of these, the critical score goes to an authentication bypass vulnerability for local domain users. Now, this one could lead to an attacker gaining admin rights if they have network access. And three of the flaws are RCEs. Now, as far as VMware knows, they aren't aware of any active exploitation of these vulnerabilities in the wild, but mitigation is very important now that they've published the CVEs and patches. Researchers warn these flaws could be used in an exploit chain, and proof of concepts are coming from the researcher who first discovered the flaw. In some news that makes me want to say, oof. That hurts. A potential post-quantum encryption standard is now basically DOA due to an attack that used 1 hour of time and a single core PC to recover its encryption keys. Oof. Yeah, that hurts. Ironically, the name of this encryption algorithm is called PSYC. Yeah, I'm not making that up. It's short for Super Singular Isogeny Key Encapsulation. Hopefully I said that right, and it's very fascinating how it works. PSYC works with SIDH, which is short for Super Singular Isogeny Diffie-Hellman. It used one step to generate the encryption key, and PSYC's co-inventor, named David Yao, told Ars Technica that the attack that broke it uses mathematics from the 1990s and the 2000s. The attack uses Genus 2 curves to attack elliptic curves, which was unexpected. PSYC could potentially be made to take two steps instead of one to prevent this kind of attack. Yao explained that this is definitely a blow to PSYC and was very transparent about their understanding of cryptography, but not the mathematics involved to recognize this kind of potential attack. Now, this attack came to light during the U.S. Department of Commerce's National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST, campaign to find post-quantum computer encryption algorithms that could replace the current algos that include RSA, Diffie-Hellman, and the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman. NIST already chose four different replacements, and these ones are called Crystals Kyber, Crystals Dilithium, Falcon, and Sphinx Plus. NIST also chose four more as potentials for further testing, and psych was one of those. From there, researchers from the Computer Security and Industrial Cryptography Group over at KU Leuven published a paper explaining how they broke the encryption using math. The paper is called An Efficient Key Recovery Attack on SIDH. Microsoft also published a bounty for breaking this encryption, which could reward up to $50,000, meaning those researchers who found this flaw could win that money. NIST has been working hard to find replacement algorithms for 5 years, and they had started with 69 candidates. Now in round four, there are three finalists left. With one of the encryption techniques being broken so far into the campaign, many researchers believe the standardization process that NIST is doing should be proceeded with conservatively, since it's possible that others could be found vulnerable to flaws as well, even late into this campaign. Y'all know what time it is. Biggest of shoutouts to my Hush Puppy perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. And a huge thank you to my newest patrons, Peter and Matt, for joining the alliance over at patreon.com/threatwire. Let's go ahead and finish out today's episode with my last top story, all about hacking the emergency broadcast system. Now, the United States Emergency Alert System encode and decoder devices could be exploited to send out fake alerts via TV and radio networks. The EAS is used to send out alerts about weather, major threats, and amber alerts, along with nationwide alerts should it be necessary, so it's a crucial part of public safety. As such, these alerts are often sent in multiple formats to be seen by the biggest potential audience, be it cable and broadcast television, satellite, and radio, both AM and FM. Now, you have probably seen these kind of alerts if you live in a place where hurricanes or tornadoes or fires are present, so basically anywhere in the US, just to name a few. The DHS issued a warning about this on August 1st after finding out about some critical security vulnerabilities in unpatched devices. FEMA sent the advisory through the Integrated Public Alert and Warning System. Security researcher Ken Pyle at cyber.com demonstrated the exploit and may present it at DEF CON this weekend. Now, Pyle discovered the issue in the Monroe Electronics R189 OneNet DASDEC EAS device. Pyle explained that they can get credentials and certs, they can exploit the web server and send fake alerts, they could also lock out legit users and disable responses too. The lack of technical information about the flaws is totally intentional, as Pyle is mainly concerned with mitigation. Now this vulnerability is public knowledge, so FEMA is asking EAS system admins to mitigate the issue by updating to the most recent software versions and security patches, setting up firewall protection, and initiating monitoring and audit logs for unauthorized access. My channel is youtube.com/ShannonMorse, just like my name is spelled, for everything from tech reviews to security tutorials. I'm working on a Pixel 6a review right now. Don't forget to like and subscribe to Hack5 as well. I'm Shannon Morse, and I will see you on the internet.